Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today. Today we're running a Moodle Academy webinar about designing for mobile and offline environments. I am Sandra Matz, Educational Events Coordinator here at Moodle HQ, and with me I have Lauren Goodman, Learning Designer at Moodle in the US, and Jianqi Deng, Program Specialist at the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning. My colleague Anna Krasa from the Moodle Academy team is also joining me today and will help facilitate the webinar. In a partnership founded in a shared commitment to open and inclusive education, the Moodle Learning Design team at the US worked with the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning to build a Digital Competencies for Literacy Educators course that is being distributed to literacy educators around the world. In this session, the speakers will demonstrate how they work together to build this course to bridge the digital divide by using core Moodle tools, such as lesson and database, as well as a mobile-first design philosophy. The speakers will share some practical strategies used to design this Moodle course for low and no bandwidth environments. We will leave some time for questions after the presentation, but please do send your questions through the chat during the presentation so that they can be addressed afterwards. So without further ado, I would like to hand over to Lauren and Jim. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra. So yeah, we are really thrilled to be here today. I'm Lauren, I'm a learning designer with Moodle US. I've been with Moodle for a year now, but when this project started, I was brand new to Moodle, not new to Moodle the platform, but brand new to the organization. And I am just thrilled that we have this chance to share the project with you today. And then we are going to get into some really specific details about the design choices we made, the tools we used, how we made things happen, because we know a lot of you come for those kind of like really practical tips. So we're really thrilled to be here, and I'm gonna hand things over to John to give you all the overview, the project, and the context that we were working in with this project.
Great, thank you, Lauren. I'm Jen from UNESCO, from the UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning in Hamburg in Germany, and we had a great experience working with Lauren and other colleagues from Moodle US. And my role here today is really to provide the overall context of this project and some of the learner and learning environment assumptions or needs that some assumptions we made about it and some things that we discovered as the project progressed. So perhaps just moving to the next slide, I can introduce why this project came about. So the UIL, UNESCO Institute for Lifelong Learning, is the secretariat for this Global Alliance for Literacy. And our main role is to act as a global platform to advocate for literacy. And one of the main gaps that we realized from the pandemic was that adult literacy educators around the world were not really supported at all in terms of skills development, nor infrastructure and other digital resources to continue their teaching and learning for their learners, adult learners around the world. So as part of this global alliance, which comprises UIL, UNESCO member states and associate members who are basically, nonprofits, some private companies, and other multilateral organizations. We worked with 30 countries, to implement projects that hope to improve youth and adult literacy. So moving on to the next slide, this project aimed to improve the digital competencies of literacy educators. Our target is 100,000 literacy educators. Trained in the effective use of technologies in literacy teaching and learning. We hope to achieve that by engaging with at least 10 countries within this alliance. And the main objective is to improve quality literacy provision by improving the capacity of these literacy educators. I'm just going to put the link of our site for the Global Alliance for Literacy in the chat right here, so that you can check it out when you have time. Next slide, please. So we already knew of Moodle. I mean, Moodle is a very well-known LMS. So we knew that Moodle was one of the main options for engaging with us on this project. We have the content, we were going to develop, and we have developed the content, and we have sort of the andragogical expertise. But what we don't have within UNESCO is really this knowledge of learning design, and also the technical aspects of creating creating or using an LMS effectively that can meet the wide range of needs amongst our member states. So why did we go with Moodle? I mean, I think one of the key reasons is that its open source philosophy really appealed to us. It aligns very well with UNESCO's principles. Obviously, the Moodle community is very strong, and we knew that we could rely on the expertise of its members, and specifically Moodle US itself. And we also had connections with Moodle through this UNESCO Global Education Coalition, which you can Google as well. So that was the three key reasons why we went with Moodle. Onto the next slide. I think we had quite a few sort of assumptions or prior knowledge of the environments that we were going to work with. These are obviously countries that UNESCO works with, countries that have generally quite challenging learning environments. They're not we call them like developing countries. So for example, on the next slide, you'll see that the learners will definitely have connectivity issues. They will not have access to the most modern of devices or most up-to-date systems. The locations really vary. There's a huge urban-rural divide specifically amongst our learners. And language is also an issue. Although maybe the language that we do business in, that we engage in, is generally English or French. I mean, the countries we work in have tens or hundreds of languages that need to be catered to ideally. They also have very diverse learning needs, and also very diverse range of prior experience with technology. Moving on to the next slide, as well as the learners, the delivery options themselves we did not want it to be prescriptive. So we wanted to offer an option that could be adapted or modified according to the needs of the country itself. So that was also very important, an important aspect of choosing Moodle as the LMS that we recommended to the countries. If I could move on to the next slide, then the last aspect was having sort of the ability to deal with issues of navigation, deployment, modification, maintenance, and distribution quite easily. Again, I think what was very attractive to us was that Moodle is open source, and that it, based on our prior research and prior engagement with Moodle, many partners, Moodle partners, and local communities in the countries that we work with existed already, as opposed to our fear that recommending a particular LMS would not give the country the chance to maybe decide on who they wanted to engage with. So sort of that choice was very important to us. We did not want to risk, I guess, appearing biased or not objective, or not giving people the option to choose what LMS they wanted to use. So yeah, those were some of the really key considerations that we ran through in our discussions with Lauren and her team as we kicked off the project. So I'll hand it back over to Lauren to dive into the nitty-gritty technical aspects of the course design.
Thanks, John. We wanted to include those three slides because I'm sure all of you out there who do instructional design or who are supporting folks in building courses, when you see all of those conditions and requirements and all of the ways that this course is meant to be used, you know, you're start just immediately thinking like, how are we going to do this? So a big part of that initial process of working together was identifying all of these different variables, because we needed to make sure that whatever we designed could function and fully function in multiple environments, right? And work for learners that had lots of different qualities and different access. So it really was, you know, it felt like quite an undertaking. And we really kind of listed these out because as we made design choices, we needed to make sure that they would function in all of these different environments. So it was a really exciting challenge. And as I start sharing with you, you know, what we ultimately made, you know, I think what's really important to know is there was a lot of collaboration, a lot of testing, a lot of iteration, a lot of research that went into making sure that what we chose to do could actually work for, you know, all of these needs and all of these environments. And the other thing just to know is, you know, we knew that this course could live in a Moodle site anywhere in the world. And so really what we ended up doing was we were designing an MBZ file, right? We were designing a course to be backed up and then sent anywhere in the world so that it could then, you know, go into that Moodle environment and be able to used fully. So all of you familiar with Moodle can immediately are thinking like, oh, okay, so you have to, you know, no plugins or like very few plugins, right? Because you just didn't know what environment this course would be restored into. And as the course is increasingly, you know, out there and shared, we just wanted to make sure that no one needed to have anything sort of special or customized, that this could really function in any environment. So just know that as we go through. And you'll see, we did use a couple of plugins, but they're not fundamentally necessary. Okay, so we can go through, we can start going. This is the Moodle part. Please feel free to ask questions. If I see them pop up in the chat, I'll try to address them, or we can just get to them afterwards in the Q&A. So first, we'll look at the course in the LMS, you know, on a computer. And I'm going to use screenshots to talk us through this. We can go into it. So here we are looking at the course from the outside. You can see that we are using the one topic format. So this is a plugin, and this is really one of the only plugins we're using. But I'll show you in a moment that this isn't, you know, a fundamental plugin. The course will be just fine if the course is in topics format. But we did decide to use one topic for a couple of reasons. One is that there's a lot of content in this course. So you can see in the top tabs that there's a course overview, and then there's three modules, and then a quick link to the student portfolios. And then within each module, there's about six sessions for each module. And we like the one topic format for this because it helped us kind of keep the page still compressed while still having a lot of content that the learners would be working through. Knowing that we have some folks who are brand new to online learning or a learning management system. And so we didn't want to overwhelm folks with a really long scroll down the page. We wanted to keep it kind of neat, simple for them. So that was a decision we made to use one topic format. And for those reasons, we also decided to use only core Moodle tools. So this course functions entirely on lesson, forum, pages, quizzes, and database, which is what we use to create the portfolio, that mechanism in the course. And I'll talk about, I'll talk about all of those, but we wanted to just use core Moodle tools. We also wanted to use core Moodle tools that fully function here, you know, on a computer in the LMS, and then also in the Moodle mobile app, both online and offline. So each of those tools I mentioned can be utilized fully offline in the Moodle mobile app, because we knew we had some learners who, you know, might only have access to the internet if they were coming to a community center or something like that, and then would need to go back to their homes and still be able to interact with the course and move through the course content offline in the mobile app. We also chose to use activity completion settings set so that the student can manually mark activities as complete. You know, we really wanted learners to feel empowered to do that as they moved through the course. So we're not using any sort of auto activity completion because we knew people might need freedom to move through the course, but we did want them to have that experience of being able to check something off when they're done, because that just always feels good. You will see that we have some intentional redundancy in where we link to activities and resources. And I'll show you more of that as we move through, but the lesson provides the real fundamental structure for this course, our lessons. That is how students really end up moving through this course. And I'll show you how that works. But we also wanted to make sure that we have links to the activities. So for example, the discussion forum, and then the portfolio activity prompt, we wanted that to be readily available right on this section page so that learners who are completing this in a face-to-face environment, you know, with a course facilitator, could easily jump to those activities. So we have links to those activities inside the lesson where we're really pacing learners and helping them move through the content and out here. And that was an intentional choice that we talked a lot about. Another choice that we talked a lot about and we had a lot of different iterations for had to do with naming conventions. And, you know, maybe that seems like a small thing, but those of you who are doing course design know how important naming conventions are, right? To arrive at something that is simple, consistent. And in our case, we also wanted to use sort of short naming conventions because when you're on the mobile app, there's a lot of, you know, cutting off that happens naturally because you're on a much smaller screen. So we decided to use module one, module two, session 1.1, right? So that's module one, session 1.2. And then we named from there. So that was really important to our process. And it took a lot of discussion and testing to see the different ways these naming conventions would display depending on what device the learner was using. So that's what we arrived at. Okay, so we can go on to our next slide here. This is just a quick look at what the course would look like in topics format. And this was, again, something we tested. We knew we wanted to use one topic. We did develop an admin guide that goes along with the course that, you know, recommends installing the one topic course format, you know, that's the recommended course format. But also, again, if someone just grabbed this backup file and restored it onto a site, we wanted to make sure that everything would still be intact, that it would still be fully functional. And luckily it is. So, you know, it drops into topics format and then you just sort of get the content scrolling down the page, but absolutely still fully functional, no loss there. So just wanted to show that to make that point. So our next view is, this is a closer look inside a module. And we, and this is a module overview page. They all look like this, right? So you're gonna see a lot of consistency as we kind of go through these screenshots. We were really trying to pare all of this down so that learners would learn how to use the course, right? That was really important in all of our design choices. You can see that we have sort of the time, how long this will take, learning objectives, a lot of standard information that you provide to learners when they start on a module. We didn't want this course, we didn't want the course file size to be very big, right? We were really trying to just conserve that space because, again, we don't know what kind of access learners have as they're downloading the actual MBZ file. And we really wanted it to be as compressed as possible. So we intentionally chose to not use things like, you know, decorative images or very large image sizes. All of the images in the course are, you know, essential to the course content. So diagrams, for example, that show like the TPACK framework for technology adoption. That's just, you know, an example. But what we did do to, you know, sort of try to break up a lot of text is we used Font Awesome icons. So those icons that you see there, you will see throughout these screenshots, they are throughout the course. And we used, you know, the same icons to signal the same content throughout the course. So that was something that we, again, took a lot of discussion and testing, but this is what we arrived at. And then finally, you can see just at the bottom of this screenshot, another Moodle feature that we relied heavily on in this course and this course design is activity name auto-linking. So, you know, the 1.1 introduction to technology and education, that will link to the lesson for session 1.1. And we needed to use auto-linking because, you know, again, this course will be restored in a site anywhere. And so we couldn't have links within Moodle, you know, to a Moodle page on that site, because that would just break if we were to back it up and use it in another Moodle site. So we rely heavily on activity name auto linking. And that also helps us to pace and structure learners through the course. Okay, so we can go to our next look. So here we are getting a closer look inside one of the lesson activities. So you can see that we took, again, this is inside a lesson activity. So this is just session 1.1, but very similar layout, similar icons here, you know, to that module overview page, because again, we just wanted folks to feel like they could recognize where they were and what they were looking at as they start moving through the course, and then hoping that it will become easier over time as they really understand how this works and how to move through. So we have the you know, look inside the lesson. We have the lesson menu over there on the left-hand side, so learners can kind of freely navigate through the lesson if they want to, because, you know, again, the purpose of this course is to prepare literacy educators. So we wanted it to also be a resource for them to be able to go back to once they're out and teaching in the field. And, you know, having the lesson menu and having free navigation through the lesson is important if later you want to go back and review something or refer to something. We'll take a closer look at this, but you'll notice in the lesson menu that we have pages for the discussion forum. So this discussion forum one, also for the portfolio activity. So the lesson is the core structure and way we're pacing students, and the lesson menu, or, you know, there's lesson pages that will actually represent and then link out to activities that learners are doing in the course. Okay. Oh, last little piece on this page. It's very subtle, but we'll take a look at this too. You'll see at the top of the page, right above the lesson title, it says export as PDF. So one of the conditions and needs of this course is that learners be able to print it, you know, or facilitators be able to print it, because there could be learners who don't have access to, you know, mobile devices and need a printed copy. And we all know that that can be a challenge, you know, and so one of the reasons that we arrived at Lesson is because there is a plugin called Export as PDF, which allows you to export an entire lesson as a PDF so that you could then print it. So that is a plugin that we're using in the course. We have that in the admin guide, and I'll show you a bit later, you know, what that looks like when you do print a lesson. But that was really important to us because, you know, that was a bit of a challenge. We were like, how are we going to print an online course? This is what we arrived at. All right, so here we are taking a closer look inside the lesson at one of those pages I mentioned that represents the discussion forum activity. So you can see here, there's again, a lot of consistency with the design and the icons and the layout. And what happens here in the discussion forum activity is we give the basic instructions. We tell users, you know, what this is, what they're going to need to complete it. And then we're using activity name auto linking to link the learner out to the actual discussion forum activity. So they do leave the lesson to go to the discussion forum activity to participate in it there. So we can go to our next slide. Okay, maybe I don't have a screenshot for this, but the last thing I'll say about the discussion forum activity is that once learners link out to that discussion forum, we also use activity name auto linking to bring them back to the lesson. So that was, you know, trying to make sure that learners don't sort of get lost in Moodle, which I know like a lot of us have probably experienced with some of our newer online learners. So activity name auto linking brings them to the forum, also brings them back to the lesson. This view here is, again, you know, the course is, you know, fully accessible. So we were really aware of things like color contrast, and the source material that we were working with had very much of I would call it sort of a textbook feel, you know, with call out boxes that are, you know, different colors and things like that. And so we wanted to kind of maintain the integrity of that, but make sure that it works in the online space. And that it's fully accessible. So what you're seeing here is, you know, what that looks like inside a lesson page. So this is a lesson content page, and you can see that we have these learn more online, these kind of like call out boxes. And we're just using some simple HTML to create that, you know, background color and shading, and then the font awesome icons. And then there's, you know, reflective activities that are embedded in the lesson pages that are just sort of for the learners to think about something or, you know, fill out a chart on their own. So that's just, you know, wanted to show you that we did try to maintain that kind of textbook feel because we thought it was, you know, more comfortable for a lot of learners while still making sure that this functions as a fully online course. Okay, so the next page here is a little peek into how we did this. So we were not, you know, we couldn't use CSS, or we didn't want to use CSS because, again, we didn't want to do anything that had to be done at the site level, or we wanted to keep that to a minimum. We really wanted this to be kind of a complete package. So we used, you know, inline HTML to make that happen. And what I ended up doing as I built this course is working directly in this HTML editor a lot. And I am like, I am not that person. I am a teacher. I am a researcher. I am not a coder or a web designer. But, you know, I think Moodle makes it really easy so that if you learn some basics, this becomes very helpful. It will also help when you're doing a lot of copying and pasting from your source material. So that was something I learned very quickly. As I worked through this and as we arrived at all of these different kind of conventions, we actually created a style guide for the course that shows all of the code that is used to create these different elements. And I can put a copy of a link to that in the chat. It's just a Google Doc, you know, but it was really just to kind of keep track and to make sure that we maintained that consistency across all of these different elements. All right, we can look now at the next piece here. So this is the portfolio activity. I think that, you know, the portfolio activities in this course were a really interesting and fun kind of like evolution that happened as we worked with the UIL team. You know, it was so important to the UIL team that this course, which, you know, primarily serves adult learners, have, you know, opportunities for authentic assessment, right, and reflection, and all of those elements that we know adult learners, you know, need to feel that they can be successful with, you know, in a learning activity. So these portfolio activities are meant for learners to do mostly sort of outside of Moodle. You know, they're interviewing someone or they're reflecting on something or they're creating a lesson plan or, you know, lots of different of these sorts of activities that are really actionable and practical. And we, of course, needed a way to, you know, find a way to sort of capture that in the platform. We wanted it to be something that could be fully used online and offline in the mobile app. And we also wanted it to be so that learners could see each other's, you know, materials if they wanted to. And if, you know, the facilitator, you know, thought that was appropriate for this, for the group. We thought about, you know, using discussion forum, like we went through a lot of different considerations. But what we arrived at is actually using the database activity for this. So if you look at the next, this next slide here, this is a look at the you know, portfolio activity submission area. That is, you know, what the learners know it as. This is a Moodle database activity. Those of you familiar with database are probably like, wow, that's like a pretty simplified database. And that was the main challenge with this, was to make it as easy as possible for the learners. And so we created buttons, these two buttons to just add an entry or view portfolios. We, you know, we have that for the main way that learners would use the portfolio, to just make it as easy as possible for them. So they're not seeing sort of like a row of buttons when they come in. So that is, and database is really powerful. Database, you know, can be used offline in the mobile app. And that was, of course, one of our main considerations there. So we had a lot of help. Sarah Ashley is one of my colleagues who is really amazing with database. If you Google her name and database activity, you'll find sessions that she's done, and she helped a lot with, you know, how to really streamline this and make it work for our purposes, which is to collect learner portfolio activities that they complete, and then also allow learners to see each other's work. Okay, so that sort of, you know, concludes the major pieces about the course and also what the course looks like on a computer. Very quickly, if we go to the next slide, you know, I'll show you some, you know, these are just some screenshots of what the course looks like as you're using it on the Moodle mobile app with iOS. We tested this course in, you know, iOS on iPhones of various, you know, whatever, various numbers of iPhones. And then also on Android devices. UIL had some really amazing interns who participated in this project and did a lot of testing for us. And that was really helpful because we had people of, you know, in all different areas and on different devices testing the course. We definitely took a mobile first design strategy with this course. Anytime we had sort of like an idea or, you know, could we do it this way, we built a prototype, you know, a quick one, and then tested it in on mobile on different devices and also in different sort of conditions. So when I was testing this course on my mobile device, I would, you know, completely turn off all connections, you know, go into like airplane mode and really just drop all of my Wi-Fi, my cell, and make sure that I could still continue to use the course. So we would even test to see what would happen if you had a connection and then your connection drops as you're working through the course, like as you're, you know, writing your discussion forum post. So we did a lot of testing with that. This next slide is one for you. You can screenshot this if you want. We, you know, we compressed the URLs, but we also have all of these resources available on the Moodle Academy page. And these are just resources that I found really valuable as I was building the course and as I was researching. So some of these are blog posts with tips about, you know, mobile-first design strategies for Moodle. The screenshot you see there is from that very first resource, which is the Moodle Features for Students. And I love this document so much because you can see there's a column for Moodle app, and it will show you if a feature is available in the Moodle app. And then it will also tell you if it's available offline in the Moodle app as just kind of like a quick way to check. So I love this resource. It was so helpful to me. Okay, so then the last piece here is just, I mentioned that, you know, this course needed to be printed, and who doesn't love an online course that we need to print? So the next slide is, this is a view of what it looks like when you use that export to PDF plugin for the lesson. And so this is one of those lesson pages, and this is what it looks like when it prints. You know, it's not perfect. The formatting is not perfect. It's not, you know, what you might get if you were using Microsoft Word or, you know, these highly designing, but it's clean, it's simple, and it provides all of that content in the course. And we wanted, you know, folks to be able to print exactly what was in the lesson, because we know that we have countries who will be translating this content. And so once they're translating the content right there in Moodle, they also, you know, they need to be able to print that translated content or that modified content as they modify lessons to meet, you know, their specific context. Okay, last slide here in this section is this. Okay, what this is what I called offline pages. So what you're seeing here is, you already kind of now have a sense of how this course works, right? And there are discussion forums with prompts. We wanted to make sure that learners who were printing the course could still access what those discussion forum prompts were. We didn't want that to be unavailable to them. So the way that we solved that problem was in the lessons, there are sort of like hidden pages. That's what I think of them as. They are pages in the lesson that do not have a jump to them. So there is a jump to the next page, right? So this jump here is to the opportunities and challenges. But there is this offline discussion forum page in the lesson itself that is jumped over. So it doesn't appear in the lesson menu. Anyone who is using this on a computer or a mobile device never sees this page. They never see this offline discussion forum page. But if you print the lesson, this will print in the right sequence in the lesson. So that was how we solved that problem. We didn't want to have redundancy or confusion for online learners about seeing the discussion forum questions twice, but we wanted to make sure that someone printing could still have access to this. So that's what you're seeing here is one of these lesson pages that is jumped over so that it can be printed, but not seen otherwise by learners. Okay, so yeah, I'm excited to see some of the questions in the chat. We just want to talk very briefly about, you know, the testing and the feedback and all that iteration that went into arriving at what you just saw. And so this first slide here, but I'm going to also just pass this back to John, is, you know, just to show you that we did, so the next slide, Sandra, if you don't mind. So we after we had built out module one and a prototype of it, we got a lot of feedback from learners, and they actually completed a survey, and then we made changes and, you know, iterated based on that feedback. So John, I'll pass this back to you to, you know, take us through a little bit of that.
Sure. Thank you, Lauren. That was a fantastic insight into the design process and the thought and the thinking behind all of the design that we, you know, you summarized it so succinctly, even though it was like many months of discussions and back and forth. Yeah, I think I just want to address this question that Jack, I see, put in the chat, asking, you know, how did we decide to use the app rather than simply let people use a mobile browser? I think the main, and whether or not downloading an app was a barrier to anyone that a browser would not be, I think the main consideration for the browser thing was the lack of reliable internet connectivity, which the app kind of allows, circumvents. In that it's usable offline, whereas I believe the mobile browser, I mean, it's not possible to continue the course once the internet drops off. And it's not just about unreliable internet connectivity. It's also, it's unreliable not because of just the general infrastructure, but also because of cost. So yeah, we envisaged a lot of situations which Lauren mentioned earlier, where a user or the educator would actually be in their center or institution where they have access to generally reliable and free Wi-Fi. And then they may have to step out or for whatever reason or head back home or anything, and they would still have access to the course. So that was really the major reason to rely heavily on that. So we went through a lot of testing and feedback. As Lauren mentioned, we did do it internally with our interns and also with some of my colleagues, but we also managed to tap on our network of literacy educators. So we had some from Bangladesh and Uganda who also kindly took their time to complete a survey and let us know any of the problems or hiccups they had with the module. And maybe one aspect that actually brought out this the export to PDF function was that during the feedback, the users actually requested, are there other alternative ways that we can make this accessible to people? So some options suggested were CDs, USB sticks, and also just being allowing it to be printed out. That's kind of those are kind of the issues or thoughts or questions that came up during this process that are real and very significant in affecting this project. So maybe the next slide. I just wanted to talk a bit about what happened after this design process and it sort of hit first contact with users and countries. And this was one example from Egypt, where we worked with the Adult Education Authority there. And one thing that we didn't take into account throughout the entire process was actually how languages are languages do not only read from left to right, and Arabic is a right to left language. And that was one key aspect that really had to be overcome when we converted the course from the English version to the Arabic version, when we contextualized it in Egypt. So the national technical team that we worked with there was really good. When I say technical team, actually, these are all education experts. They're not necessarily technology experts, but there was a wide range of stakeholders, from government officials to literacy educators to some IT experts or people who had experience with online learning and online course design, who kind of came together in a group and we spent a week working together to contextualize the content, but also figure out how the Moodle side of things would work in Egypt. So that was one thing. We also took the opportunity to see how the literacy educators and the other participants in the workshop reacted or were able to use Moodle first off with basically no orientation. And what we found out was maybe one third of the participants could log in and access a discussion forum and answer a question and post with no problems, with no assistance. One third needed a bit of assistance. Sometimes it was with the login, sometimes it was just with posting, making a post. And one third of them needed quite significant one-on-one assistance. So considering the background of these people, Tepa, in the workshops, they're relatively highly educated. They are, I think their economic background is generally maybe middle to upper rather than covering the whole range. And so we were actually still quite shocked, that we were facing these problems in the workshop and it was taking up time and needed assistance. So The whole point of my recounting this experience is that, in spite of what we all hope to achieve in, you know, the iteration and testing, when it finally sort of hit the ground, I mean, a whole set of issues came up when it was deployed or tested. The second point was really significant as well. It's also related to our experience in the workshop where a huge range of devices were used. And like I saw some Android devices that I haven't seen personally in a really long while, like 10 years ago. And I'm pretty sure the systems they were using were also like older. So in spite of what we assumed would be compatibility with a wide range of devices and things, it didn't quite work out as we expected. So that is, you know, I don't think, as far as I know, Lauren, I don't think we can tackle that because we've sort of stripped it down to as basic as it could be. And but it was just quite an interesting observation of how, in spite of all our precautions and anticipation, you know, it didn't quite work out so well. And the third point, of course, is the wide range of digital skills. So, I mean, yeah. And when I say wide range, obviously the ones that are more challenging are those who have not really done any online, have zero online learning experience. And maybe they use their phones mainly for telephone calls, maybe for the occasional Facebook or social media access, but not for learning. So that was also something we could observe in our workshop group. That was our experience in Egypt, and not just limited to Egypt. We also have rolled it out in Nigeria, Bangladesh, and Cote d'Ivoire as well. So that's another set of like different culture, different languages. A lot of observations from those experiences. Next slide, please. Lessons learned. So I'll take this first, Lauren. Yeah. So maybe just to summarize, three lessons or three observations that I had and we had from the experience last year. I think taking off immediately from what I just recounted, it's really important to allow for space and time to observe first contact between users and when they engage with the course. And I would say we didn't have enough time. So we didn't have enough time, not for, you know, they were for external reasons, like relating to the project implementation. But we were working on a very tight timeline. So I think, you know, when it goes into the field or when it goes into different cultures and you know, when the course will be in another language, even during contextualization, so important to have the space, like a safe space, open space, and also allow enough time to observe and then to make changes to the course. I think the second point was a really good endorsement, I guess, of our initial approach, which was to obtain inputs from a diverse range of stakeholders. So typically when we engage with governments, sometimes they are quite, you know, there may be quite a siloed way of thinking. So they kind of just want to engage with their usual group. And we do try to encourage our focal points and the people who are working with us in these different countries to bring in people from the Ministry of Communications, Ministry of IT, bringing in, you know, a significant portion of the, a good number of the literacy educators who are actually the target group into the discussion right from the start, rather than sort of have them come in later on. Nonprofits or important non-governmental organizations are also really big implementing partners in adult literacy, youth and adult literacy in many countries. It's not really actually a government thing in a lot of our member states. So it was so important to have, and private sector, sorry. I mean, I definitely should not have forgotten that, private sector as well. So Having these stakeholders in the room right from the start when we introduce this project and give time for it to be contextualized is so important to the process. And the third point is actually, it's not so much a lesson learned, but we found that, people appreciated the assumptions and the logic and the rationale behind a hybrid learning format, which is kind of how, which was how this course was designed based on. But we really also hope to develop like a self-paced learning version this year, because a lot of the stakeholders in different countries are like, yes, it's great that we have this course that's, you know, hybrid and we'll need facilitation and a moderator, but we also want to expand the reach, you know, to even people who may benefit from it, who are not from our initial target group. So for example, in Nigeria, actually, some of the university faculty that took part in our workshop, they said, oh, this would even be beneficial for our first year undergraduates, you know, in the education faculty or adult learning or adult literacy modules or courses that they have. So, I mean, that was pleasantly surprising for us. Yeah. Okay, I'm done.
And I think I've shared mine throughout, so, you know, just very quickly, this as I was building, just testing often in all these different connection scenarios, that was so important. And, you know, these are obviously things that I know, we know, but, you know, when you're actually working on a project of this scale, I just think it really sinks in. And it's important, you know, just sort of reflecting. These are kind of my major takeaways after all this work. This one is very simple, but just using the HTML editor directly when you need to do a lot of copying and pasting is some of my most practical advice for all the content creators out there. You save yourself a lot of hassle with later cleaning up formatting that comes through. And then finally, just how important collaboration was on this project. There were so many folks who worked on this in different ways, and I definitely personally, you know, my favorite part about it is the relationship that I formed with Jan and others at, you know, the UI at UIL. It's really been great. And it was so fun to work with all the interns and just different folks who contributed throughout the process. So I think now we're moving to questions. I've tried to answer some questions in the chat, but I'm sure we've missed some. I could read one that I saw that I think would be a good Jian question to answer. How long did course development take from the initial idea to now? How many people were involved? UNESCO, Moodle, and others? Approximate cost to develop? I recognize much is involved. So, you know, sort of, Jian, do you want to just talk about that a little bit? The overall time?
Yeah, sorry, I was responding to Jody's point. The overall time was approximately, it was approximately more than that, actually. I would say about 4 months. Because we did have to actually set up the sort of the framework, the kind of skills that the educators were expected to develop, and then work through the content, of course. Before that, we also surveyed the existing material that was available globally that was relevant to this area, which unfortunately was really limited. I would say most of the best material came from different literacy organizations in America, in North America, so the US and Canada. Yeah. Sorry, did I miss other points? The cost? Did I hear?
Yeah, that was part of the question, was kind of the project logistics.
I mean, the cost is the cost for the design, I think it was, what was it? Maybe was it 20 to 30,000? overall, but it's separate from the content. So the content and the content of the course itself. So I'm not sure if what you meant was like the online course or the, you know, the course content, the instructional design or the course design versus the content of the course. The content of the course was more than the cost of creating the online course. But yeah, I think for the online courses, it was like 20, I think, ish, 20-ish thousand. Yeah.
Should we just quickly scan the questions through the chat? Most of them have been already answered, but just to be a little bit inclusive, somebody asked for the MBZ file of the course, and Jian has already answered that it will be available after the piloting to Moodle 4 in a couple of months. Jack asked, how did you decide to use the app rather than simply let people use mobile browser? And that's already answered by Laureen. The need for the course to be used offline was the main reason, the major decision to rely heavily on the app. And Vanessa says, thank you for the excellent presentation. Why you decide to choose a lesson instead of book? And you discussed about the header form, but what was the reason behind that? Lorraine, would you like to sum up your answer?
Yeah. The reason for the hidden pages were skipping over the lesson pages was so that the content could be printed, because the discussion forum prompts were in the forum activities themselves, not in the lesson. But for those learners who were printing the entire lesson, we wanted them to have access to the prompts as well, you know, because maybe they were participating in a mostly face-to-face discussion with their colleagues, you know, in a community center or something like that. The other question, I answered it kind of quickly in chat, but was around version, the Moodle version. The screenshots you saw are from the UIL Moodle site, which is on 3.11, or at least the time when we were working on this was on 3.11. When I built the course, I built it in my own sandbox. Intentionally, I built it in 3.10 because I actually wanted to be working in an older version of Moodle to then see what would happen as I restored into more recent versions. And Moodle 4.0 was actually released while we were working on this project. So we did have a chance to test the course in 4.0.
Nicole asked about the recording of this session where we've reached already the hour. Yes, the recording will be available from the course in Moodle Academy and of course in our channel in YouTube.
Just a few wrap-up notes before we finish. If you have enjoyed the session, we'd love you to consider getting involved further and help us grow by contributing to the development of Moodle Academy. You can do this by visiting our Get Involved course, which you will find on the front page of the Moodle Academy site. You can suggest ideas for new webinars and courses, and you can vote on ideas that have been suggested by others already. We're always on the lookout for community members to help present webinars and co-create short online courses. And we'd love your help making Moodle Academy more inclusive. So if you're able to, please jump into our Translate Moodle Academy course and get started with helping us translate our courses and webinars into other languages, something we've talked about a lot today. And of course, please help spread the word about Moodle Academy by telling your colleagues about the courses we offer and the events we run. When you complete a course, you will earn a badge. Educators might like to think about getting involved with the Moodle Educator Certificate, MEC. You can take the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz, and one of our certified service providers will support you through the certification process. Well, that's all from my side. Thank you for joining us today. We hope you found this useful and enjoyable, as we did. And we hope to see you on the Moodle Academy course forums and also attending upcoming webinars. If you have any further questions, you can write them on the discussion forum in the affiliated course for the Moodle community to answer. So thank you again for joining us today. And thank you to the speakers for being here today. And we hope to see you soon at future Moodle Academy webinars.